signals. This is an intercalated system such that the short-term system acts in part through the long-term system and vice versa. You may have heard about some of these short-term signals, and I should mention that it is these that are thought to be the targets of gastric bypass, which manipulates the levels of these hormones. Now, it's been reasoned for a number of years that you would need a combination therapy for obesity that would treat both the long and the short-term systems, because if you targeted only one, the other one could compensate. And so the story I'll briefly tell you now is about a combination between leptin and a short-term signal named amylin, which is made by pancreatic beta cells and is a short-term signal. Amylin is a 37 amino acid peptide approved for the treatment of diabetes in the U.S., sold as Simlin. It's co-secreted from pancreatic beta cells with insulin, and treated patients show a durable 5% weight loss. Amylin appears to work in a number of ways. It suppresses glucagon secretion, suppresses glucose absorption, as well as acts on brain stem centers to reduce weight. And what's shown here now is the combination of amylin and leptin. This is two studies show similar data. And this combination achieves 14% weight loss in the studies that have been done so far, as compared to 5% in either of the monotherapy arms and even more than in the placebo arm. So it looks like combining this long-term agent in leptin and the short-term agent in the form of amylin might have some benefit in time for the treatment of obesity, although, of course, further trials will be required to confirm its safety and efficacy. Now, as scientists, we'd most like to understand the molecular basis of leptin resistance, and this will require that we understand, in a sense, the neural circuit that responds to leptin and what's different about it in the leptin-resistant state. There's much to be learned about this, but the logic of the system has been deduced in recent years in the form of specific neural populations that respond to leptin and regulate food intake. Leptin acts on groups of neurons in the brain, in the hypothalamus. One group expresses the receptor for leptin and the peptide NPY, and when these neurons fire, an individual or an animal eats more. A second neural population expresses the leptin receptor and MSH, and when these neurons fire, an animal or a human will eat less. And leptin works by regulating the balance of these two. It inhibits these neurons and activates these neurons, so that in the absence of leptin, these are maximally active and you eat more. With extra leptin, these are maximally active and you eat less. And the system is tuned so that quantitative changes in leptin concentration change the relative activity of these pathways. These pathways have attracted a great deal of attention in recent years because mutations in it cause human obesity. We now know that more than 10% of human obesity is a result of defects in one of these four genes. These are Mendelian defects: leptin, its receptor, MSH, or its receptor, the MC4 receptor. So we already know that more than 10% of morbid obesity is the result of a Mendelian defect, and I suspect that number will continue to grow as we screen with newer sequencing technologies to identify genetic defects that lead to differences in weight in families. I should also mention that this evolving understanding of the neural chemistry that regulates weight is leading to, will lead in time, I think, to a new generation of therapies that modulate these neural circuits more specifically than do current treatments for this condition. So I think in the long term, the question for us is going to be, how does this molecule change a complex behavior? Because there's no question that leptin reduces food intake and body weight. This just shows the reduction in food intake in obese mice given leptin. It's rather profound. And you see the same thing in leptin-deficient children. This child ate more than 2,000 calories at a test meal before his first dose of leptin, but after four or five injections now ate the age-appropriate number of calories. Feeding is what's known as a complex motivational behavior. Many factors influence the likelihood that we will eat, but none guarantee it. So in addition to leptin and the other metabolic signals I mentioned, there are a variety of other sensory, emotional, and higher cognitive factors that also regulate appetite. This has implied that there must be a part of our brain that collates this information and makes a decision about whether to eat. And not only do we not know how complex information of this sort is represented in the brain, we don't even know where it's represented. so anatomically. So there's a great deal of research that lies ahead of us to try to understand how feeding behavior is regulated without resorting to the simplistic notion that this is something we consciously decide alone. And so the future for research, I think, will be to understand the genes that control how behavior is modified in response to specific inputs. Now, it's my so what we're left with, I think, is the fact that body weight is regulated by a feedback loop composed of an afferent signal and leptin, integratory centers in the brain, and a set of end organ effects. And it's my view that it's only by understanding more about this system that we'll be able to develop improved therapies. The current advice we give the obese goes something like this: they should eat less and exercise more. This was the advice of Hippocrates 2,000 years ago, and I'd like to argue that modern science might be able to provide a better recommendation than one that's 2,000 years old. And so what I think we need to do in approaching this problem is deal with it in the way we would any other medical condition, understand the physiologic basis for the system, define the pathophysiologic influences on it, of course consider how environment and behavioral factors influence, and from this will come new therapies. Now, I'm often asked, and I'll close with this one set of remarks, well, what would you tell patients in the absence of approved medical therapies, at least for this condition? And so I'll close at least with what I consider to be one way to consider approaching this problem. I think the focus should be on improving health. I think the cosmetic elements of obesity are not worth thinking about. This is something that changes over eons. Sometimes it's fashionable to be thin. Sometimes it's fashionable to be less thin. I think the focus should be on improving health. This means for everyone, exercise and eat a heart healthy diet, whether you're obese or not, but especially if you're obese. Now, it's also the case that the health benefits of weight loss are significant even with modest amounts of weight loss. And so I advise people to do their best to lose some weight. I think weight loss of 7 to 10 or so pounds is achievable, and you can get a disproportionate health benefit from this. And I think this is achievable, whereas trying to normalize your weight if you're way overweight is considerably more difficult and less likely to work. People should not, however, berate themselves if they can't normalize their weight. There's a very powerful biological system that maintains homeostatic control of weight that obese individuals would be fighting against. And then finally, don't berate anyone else either. So with that, I'd like to thank you again for giving me the opportunity to visit this fascinating country and share in the excitement of what's being built here. So I'll stop and would be happy to take any questions if there's time.
Perhaps I could start with questions, Dr. Freeman. If an individual has liposuction, what are the acute changes and what's in the long term?
You know, I don't know that any careful studies have been done on this. They may have been, but I'm not aware of them. But I do know that liposuction is not an effective long-term therapy for the treatment of obesity, and it's presumably because you remove a source of leptin, these individuals have low leptin levels for a period of time, which is a stimulus to return the weight to the starting point. And studies of that sort have been done in animals, and the data are consistent with what I just said. So this is a system designed to make sure you have adequate amounts of fat at any point in time.
Yes.
Is the type of fat, saturated or unsaturated, or the location, epicardial versus visceral, or the age of the fat, newly put on fat versus old fat, important?
So that's a good question. I mean, all fat makes some leptin. Different depots make different amounts. So visceral fat actually tends to make proportionally a little bit less leptin per cell than subcutaneous fat. But all fat makes some leptin, so it's not as though the brain can't sense the aggregate amount of fat. Now, there's a separate question that's a great mystery here, which has to do with the comorbidities associated with visceral adiposity. And it's not clear at all why that's associated with increased morbidity, but it's not attributable in any easy way I can understand to the amounts of leptin they make or how they respond to it. So there's a lot of regional differences in the character of fat, and that's a really, it's an open question as to why that is or how that develops.
Dr. Gatto.
Well, first of all, Jeff, that was a beautiful talk, and thank you for coming over here to share your fascinating results with us. My question is regards to therapy. The United States Food and Drug Administration recently approved a combination of naltrexone, which has been approved for some time for alcoholism, and wellbutrin, which is an antidepressant to treat obesity. Is it known how, or do you know how this would affect the leptin system?
Okay, so if I'm not mistaken, the advisory panel recommended the approval.
No, it's. I think it's approved now.
You're talking about contrary?
I'm not sure. I'm not confident.
Well, speaking at a general level, all of the agents that have been developed or used for obesity since dinitrophenol have targeted these CNS pathways. And most of the agents that have been used thus far have been relatively nonspecific. So, for example, fen-phen was a serotonin reuptake inhibitor, which would activate all serotonergic pathways. Similarly, the drugs you describe have a rather broad mechanism of action neurochemically. There's extremely convincing evidence that many of these agents modulate the neurons that I spoke about. So, for example, serotonin can modulate the activity of these POMC neurons or MSH neurons. Dopamine can do likewise, as can other monoamines. So I think what's happening is the drugs that either cause weight loss or in some cases weight gain, such as neuroleptics, all modulate these pathways, but they're nonspecific, and so there are lots of off-target effects that can account in some cases for toxicities. So I think that there's a lot of reason to be hopeful that as we learn more about the specific neural pathways that regulate weight, that effective but safer therapies that are more specific to those pathways will be developed. So I think in the medium to long term, I'm optimistic. The short term is one that's sort of a difficult one because the drugs that are out there probably are not as good as the ones that will come to be in the future. And so they're running into side effects. And I think at some level there's some discouragement now about the failure to find truly effective, safe drugs. Now, that's setting aside the hope that maybe this combination of leptin and amylin or other biologics that are in development might have better efficacy. Time will tell.
Todd?
I was wondering if you could comment on the expression of the leptin receptor in other organs systematically, which might give clues about the action of leptin in the systemic circulation in addition to what is known in the brain.
So that's a really important question. So my view, based on the available evidence, is that the primary action of leptin is directly on the brain. There are reports of leptin receptor in peripheral tissues, but they don't tend to be the functional form of the receptor. There are non-functional forms. The exception to that is the immune system, where there are clearly direct effects of leptin on a number of immune cells. Now, this is really an important question because if obese people have high leptin levels and you had a lot of peripheral effects of leptin and you were not resistant to those, it could be a bad thing and could contribute to comorbidities even. I think that's an important theoretical point, but there doesn't appear to be any evidence to support it. And so I think in the absence of any data that's not yet been available, I wouldn't attach too much significance to direct effects of leptin on sites outside the brain other than immune cells.
Yes.
What is the relationship of leptin to insulin metabolism, if any, and its role in causation of metabolic syndrome?
So the combination of the relationship between leptin and insulin is complex conceptually, at least. When we first found leptin, I thought it was going to be very simple. Insulin was the anabolic hormone, leptin is a catabolic hormone, and they'll do opposite things. I can't say it works as simply as that. The best example being here, you take insulin-resistant patients, lipodystrophic patients, or insulin-deficient patients, type 1 diabetic animals and perhaps patients, and you give them leptin and you improve insulin resistance. So I think there's a, all I would say is that there's a complex inter, you improve it. So there's a complex interplay, and they each have their own independent effects on glucose metabolism, but it's not as simple as saying they oppose each other in any way, because if they did, you would suggest that leptin should worsen insulin resistance, and it doesn't. You know, I don't think, so another way to put it is that insulin probably arose before leptin, but it's not as though leptin arose as an antidote to insulin. Rather, it filled a biochemical and physiologic niche to help coordinate, to integrate fat mass into body physiology.
Yes.
Is there any epigenetic factors that control leptin resistance that you can think of? And the other question is chronic low inflammation somehow leads to leptin resistance as relates to the question Dr. Sheikh was asking.
So the issue of epigenetics to me is a complex one. I would say that I don't think there is any environmental influence that is likely to change leptin sensitivity from generation to generation, which is at some levels what epigenetics describes. I am absolutely sure that leptin or nutritional factors can influence responsiveness to leptin and responses of cells to leptin, and that will be encoded at some level at the chromatin structure, but I don't think that's passed on from generation to generation in some way. So let me restate that. I think environmental factors undoubtedly change the way that this system works and the way that hormones and other factors act on cells. Now, the reason I'm being cautious about this is because there were some reports about effects of folate deficiency on agouti mice and stably changing obesity over generations based on that dietary manipulation, and I don't see that personally as being applicable to the human condition or to many other settings such as high fat feeding, but it's hard to disprove something like that. So I'm just expressing my point of view on it.
I'd like to thank Dr. Friedman for such a terrific talk, and we'll turn it over to the round table. Thank you, Dr. Friedman.
Good morning. I'm Barbara Howard from the United States, and with me is Miriam Abraham Al-Masi Al-Hajari from Bahrain. And it's our pleasure to do this session on the management of the obese patient. And I'll turn it over first to Dr. Al-Hajari, who will introduce the speakers.
Thank you. In this session, good morning for everybody. In this session, we'll talk about the management of obese patients, and we will start with Barbara Howard. She will give us about the dyslipidemia of obesity. Mrs. Barbara, she's a Medistar Health Research Institute and Georgetown University School of Medicine in Washington, USA. Welcome to Mrs. Barbara.
Thank you. I would, too, like to thank the organizing committee, the Weill Cornell Medical School, the Lorenzini Foundation, and a very large shukran to the Qatar Foundation and Dr. Sheikh and his group here. For the privilege of attending this conference. my topic is the dyslipidemia of obesity, and I will try to cover two simple points in this time that I have. First, I'll spend a little bit of time. Excuse me? You can't hear. Is this on? Can you hear? Can you hear me now? Okay. I think I just didn't. The other speaker must have been a lot taller. But anyway, I want to review the effects of obesity on lipoprotein metabolism. I'll do that briefly, and then briefly explore the possibility that is an obvious sequitur of our previous talk, that there may be ethnic differences in association of obesity and lipoproteins, and I'll try to emphasize what we do know about the Middle East. Now, I don't want to turn this into a basic biochemistry class and put you all asleep, but as you know, when you measure triglycerides and LDL cholesterol and HDL cholesterol, you're really measuring a complex group of particles, and the HDL, the LDL, and the VLDL that carry most of the triglycerides are a group of particles that vary in composition, size, and metabolic properties. Now, I can summarize. I'm going to summarize before I explain, but this is the basic point, that in obese individuals, all aspects of those lipoproteins can be influenced. There's usually consistently some effect on triglycerides, elevating them, and some effect on HDL, lowering them. The LDL effects are more complex, often elevation, not always, and then always abnormalities in the composition of the particles. The bottom line is that multiple aspects of the metabolism that controls these particles are altered in obese individuals, and the driving forces generally are the increased levels of free fatty acids and cytokines that are produced by the increased adipose mass. Now, this is, we all have cartoons that describe lipoprotein metabolism, and as you all know, it starts with the liver with the production of the VLDL particles driven by a complex set of factors, including fatty acids and the cytokines. These VLDL are metabolized in the circulation and ultimately produce LDL. HDL are start with liver production from liver and other tissues of a small particle that then receives cholesterol from the circulation, and then there's a complex interaction between HDL and the other ApoB containing particles, and this is key to understanding why there's generally a coordinated change in VLDL and HDL, and things that drive up triglycerides and VLDL tend to decrease HDL. So, if you want to summarize the metabolic changes, generally there's always a change in the up direction for total triglycerides, which are mainly VLDL, and it's because of many effects, including production of triglycerides driven by the free fatty acids, effects on ApoB production, effects on clearance because of lipase changes, and composition changes. Parallelly, this goes down. There's a triglyceride enrichment because of exchange between these two compartments. Then you get more clearance of HDL. There's a decreased proportion of the large ones, and therefore they're dysfunctional. LDL is the one that can have different effects. Often it's in the up direction because you're making more of the precursor, which is VLDL. But there's triglyceride enrichment with cholesterol lowering because of the exchange with HDL, and there can be either decreased or increased receptor-mediated clearance. So going back to this cartoon, basically you're driving things in this direction, and you're driving the exchange process that's resulting in more of this, less of this, and often more of this, but that's not always the case. So that is the summary of lipoprotein metabolism in a nutshell. And with that, I will proceed to then explore, which is what plagues us clinically, is the relationship between obesity and lipids. And it's been related in by several of the previous talks that obese individuals are a clinical problem, not just because of the excess weight, but because of the comorbidities, and dyslipidemia is a very common one, as you all know. And what I'd like you to focus on is population variation, because actually that's why we're here. Like all biomedical research, it often starts with Northern European Caucasians, and we form one conclusion. But then as we begin to look at other populations in the U.S. and throughout the world, we find that there's quite a bit of heterogeneity, not surprising. And I think that it's important for clinical care in this part of the world to understand the actual specifics of what's happening and how obesity is influencing lipoproteins here in the Middle East. So I want to start first by showing you some data that suggests that there are certainly ethnic differences in the overall patterns of the effect of obesity. Not that there isn't the same metabolic changes, but maybe they're to a different extent modulated by genetic and environmental factors. These are NHANES data. It's a big population-based study from the United States, and I want you to focus on blacks and whites, and that men on top and women in the bottom. But if you look at the whites, if you take, for example, the best example, the white women, whose triglycerides almost double as you go from normal weight to overweight to obese. But look at the black women who start out lower and have at most a 20 to 25 point rise in triglycerides as they go from overweight to obese. Now, these are African Americans in the United States. There's a fair amount of admixture in that population. But these are data from West Africans showing basically the same trend, where in men in the dark bars and women in the light bars, starting at rather low levels of triglyceride and going from overweight to obese, having at best a 25-point rise in triglycerides. Here's another example of perhaps ethnic differences. It's from the Strong Heart Study. This is a population-based sample of American Indians. It's not the Pima study. But the point is, this population's turned out to be a valuable model for populations through the world who have high rates of obesity and diabetes and these diabetes-associated cardiovascular disease. This summarizes our data in one slide. And I want to, this is triglycerides and on the left, HDL on the right, in men and women in this cohort. These are 45 to 74-year-old men and women. Here's HDL men and women going from the BMI levels with the different colors going from 25 to 40. And look at the effect in men. You get almost a doubling of triglycerides as you go through.